All right, it's 57 minutes after 7. I promise we're going to have a dreams conversation. I remember the song, When You Dream, Dream Big. Yeah, it might just happen. How true is that? When you have terrible dreams, do you dream big as well? But dreams are said to be sequences of images, ideas, and emotions, and feelings that occur unwillingly in the mind during certain stages of sleep. This is the grammar, or if you like, English definition of dreams. People who are in the spirit also have their definition of dreams and the anatomy of dreams. So we've been joined by a man who's written a book on dreams. He knows how to interpret it, and he's just told me that you can program your mind to dream positive dreams. So there's a secret to share right here on the show. I've got Obed Obin Adai. He's the author of the book Biblical Anatomy of Dreams. I got Adai correct, did I?
Yes, you did.
All right. You're also the senior pastor of Christ Cosmopolitan Incorporated.
Yeah.
Okay, tell me about your church.
Our church is a worldwide commission of God that started in the year 2000.
Okay.
And so we've been around for the past 16 years. And we are all over the country, and currently, our headquarters is in Kumasi.
Okay.
And we have members across the globe, and we transmit to various places in all of our networks.
Mm.
And we are also in Accra here.
All right.
Doing big and small things for God.
Okay. But maybe I'll pay you a visit one of these days.
We'll be looking forward to it.
I don't like paying visits, but I will try.
Please do.
Okay.
You'll love it.
But first of all, tell us about what inspired you to write this book. And this is it, The Biblical Anatomy of Dreams, a classic prayer manual.
Exactly.
I was expecting it to be, you know, like just a book and just read. But you've got a lot of verses and texts.
Yes.
So what's the inspiration?
The inspiration had to do with filling a gap. I go to the bookstores and I realize that there are lots of materials on dreams, but they actually express people's experiences, and you barely would have any material that is founded on the Word of God enough to let you know what God has to say on dreams.
Okay.
So this particular book, that's how come, is a biblical anatomy of dreams.
Mm.
So it's founded on the Word to help the average believer, everybody, to program the outcome of their dreams. And you know, dreams are spirit-controlled images. And so if you're able to win in your dreams, then you can win in the physical realm as well.
Always, always?
Always, always.
Okay, but if you lose in your dream,
then you would not have to wake up and manage it.
I used to experience this, so perhaps I'll start, with that. And a colleague, once I started saying what I used to say, yes, it used to happen to me as well, especially in the afternoon. So I stopped sleeping in the afternoon. You want to wake up.
Yeah.
You are shouting, but it's not coming.
Hmm.
Nobody can hear you. You know you're doing the thing in the dream.
Yeah.
But you're trying to wake yourself up and you can't wake up. What's that?
It's interesting. As soon as you started speaking and you said afternoon, then I know why you had those bad dreams.
Okay.
Because according to the Word of God, the day is not for sleep. You are supposed to sleep in the night. So there are laws in this universe that govern sleep. And if you should go against it, then your dream world becomes a field play for the enemy to invade it.
Are you saying you can't take a nap in the afternoon?
That's not what I'm saying. I mean to say that you'll have to understand the laws that control sleep and dreams. Now, if you take a nap, then it has to be a nap. It must not be that which is compared to the sleep you have in the night. You see? So if you should fall into a deep sleep in the day, as you should do in the night, then now you are going against the laws of the universe.
Yeah.
And for that matter, you must make sure that you have already programmed your spirit enough to be able to fall deeply into sleep in the day, else your dream world will become a field play for the devil.
Wow.
Yes.
One thing outstanding, at least from the point where I got to, because I confess to you that I'm not quite finished reading the book,
yes,
is the fact that you don't necessarily have to pray, at least for you, before you go to bed.
No, you don't have to.
Why not?
Because it is just a sign of fear. And fear is what programs you for bad dreams. And it is not a must. If you do it, it's okay. But if you must not go to sleep praying that God come over and do something for me, or in the name of Jesus as I'm going to sleep, that kind of disposition quickly disposes you to fear. And fear is what makes your dream a false play for the enemy.
Yeah.
You see. So if you are able to go to sleep confidently, assured that you are the beloved of God, the Bible says he giveth his beloved sweet sleep. It's your right as a child of God. It's your entitlement as a child of God to have sweet sleep. And God gives you sweet sleep.
We'll come back with that sweet sleep and the definition, because you've got a definition for that as well.
Yes.
But let's start from the basics.
Okay.
Why do we dream?
Interesting. You said it's basics, but the question you asked is broad.
It's not,
so
okay.
I'm going to start from the foundations.
Sure.
When you say dreams, others think that dreams are just mental images that go through the mind. But that is not the foundation of dreams. Dreams actually are a communication of a word that comes to you, and you hear a little of it with your ears. And as far as they enter your ears, your mind picks it up, and the words that came to you become mental images in your sleep state. So the word of God says in the book of Job, he said, a word was brought to me, and I heard a little thereof. Then it became a dream for me. So words actually are the foundations of all things in this universe. And during the day, God has been trying to get your attention to speak to you.
Mm-hmm.
And you've been so busy that you could not hear it. So in the book of Psalms, he says that the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament also show his handiworks. Then in the verse 2, he says, day after day, pours forth speech, and night after night, pours forth knowledge. So during the day, there is the pouring out of the glory of God in speech to you. But some of the times, because of our schedule and our work, we are so busy inside, and there's so much noise inside, that we are unable to pick up the signals God is giving us.
Mm.
And when God sends that way, it is stored in the spirit realm, or in your spirit. Then now, when you go to sleep, at that moment, you begin to convert the words that were sent to you in your mind into a mental image. Let's break it down. Man is a spirit. He has a soul. He lives in a house called a body. Now, the spirit is the essence of man. The soul is the expression of the spirit in the house called the body. And the body is the vehicle for that expression.
Mm.
So now, when you lay the body to sleep, you have two elements now that become the field play for dreams. Your soul is the first opening into the dream world. Then the highest depths of reality. And if you're able to program in the spirit or in your spirit, then all your realities that show up in your physical body and in your physical environment will be according to what was programmed in your spirit. You see? So the word that was sent to you by God is stored in your spirit. So your spirit man becomes a repository of that word. Then your soul opens up in the night because you laid this body, the vehicle for manifestation, to sleep. But understand that it was day upon day that the word was sent to you. Then in the night, the awakening, Songs of Songs chapter 5, the verse 2, he says that I sleep, but my heart awakens. The reason why lots of people don't dream is because they have not learned to awaken their heart in sleep.
So how do you do that?
Now, you do that by the inbuilt word of God that you put within you, and the meditations that you do before you sleep.
Hmm.
You see, you must not wander about. You must rather set your mind on the word. David says, I waken in the night watches, and my mind is stayed on you. So when your mind is stayed on the Lord, he keeps you in perfect peace. And that peace is translated into your dream state or into your dream world for a sweet sleep.
So let me make a confession here, and you tell me if, because it's making a lot of sense to me right now.
Okay.
Sometimes the dream that I have, surprisingly, has to do with work.
Yes.
Is it because I slept, I was doing a lot of reflection on work.
Okay. So now it translates into your dream, you see. And where you have a negative field about work before you go to sleep, you are sure to have programmed yourself into a bad harvest that you are going to reap in your dream state.
So instead of thinking about how bad the day was or something that I was supposed to have finished that I couldn't finish,
yes.
If I took a message, if I took a word and I just read it,
yes.
Would I be reflecting on that? Should I dream that night?
If you did.
Okay.
If you did. Because he is able to keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on him. So what do you stay your mind on before you sleep? So you see, if you were even praying that God should keep you and your mind was on the fear that was awaiting you in your dream state, you just gave yourself over and you're going to have bad dreams.
You also say in your book that sometimes it will be God trying to tell you something, which you've said now, but also warning your enemies. And I was wondering, so God warns your enemies in a dream. How?
It's interesting that right from the Old Testament down into the New Testament, we see God come by way of his children to warn the enemies of his children on their behalf. The first time we see that with Abraham. Abraham meets with Abimelech, and Abimelech takes his wife Sarah. And Abraham can't do anything about it because he's afraid that if he should say that Sarah is his wife, Abimelech is going to kill him. Then Abraham goes to God. God, you have to come through for me. My wife has been taken away from me. God says, don't worry. I meet the young man who is the king in the night. So in the night, God appears to Abimelech and says that he's a prophet. Don't touch his wife, else you face the consequences. That is an example of how God could go and warn your enemies in a dream. Now, when Jesus was about to be crucified, you remember Pontius Pilate. His wife had a dream, and he said, I have been warned, and I have suffered many things in a dream. So have nothing to do with that holy man. Then he washes his hands of Jesus. That was what happened. Lastly, Jacob is with his master Laban, who is an uncle, and he serves, and then he stole away. He's gone, not knowing his wife Rachel had stolen the idols of his father's house. Now Laban is on the chase after Jacob, that if he should find him, he has in his right to do him evil. But this Jacob is connected to Abrahamic blessing and Abrahamic covenant, so you can't just come your way and hurt the child of God. What did God do? God appeared to Laban, who was an idol worshiper. He wasn't a believer, and warned him not to touch Jacob. He meets with Jacob and said, the God of your father Abraham and Isaac appeared to me last night. It is in my power to do you evil, but I have been warned by God not to touch you. It is the right of the believers in this present age, and it has spanned the ages, right from time, from Abraham. And if you see something happen to Abraham, and you see it happen to Jesus, and you see it happen to Jacob, then you have entered into covenant blessings.
I was going to just ask, does it happen today?
It happens today.
Have you experienced it? I mean, how would you know? Because he's talking to your enemy.
Several times. My enemies have come to me on a couple of occasions to confess to me what sometimes they have intended to do to me, and how by a strange means they have refrained from doing it because of a dream that they had. It happens. And God still is in that same business. And the issue is that Jesus, or the God we serve, does not change. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the Bible says that God does not change.
Yeah.
So the God, especially if you find something in the Old Testament and you see its application in the New Testament, then you should know that God is still in that same business of warning your enemies on your behalf to keep off from doing you any harm. And that is especially if it lies in their power physically to hurt you, you see. Now, if it's a spiritual matter that your enemies are arranging against you spiritually, then God still, by means of the agency of the Holy Spirit, can still put them to flight. You see?
Sure. Yeah. And you can send us messages. I'm getting messages already. What I want us to do today is, so apart from the things that I am asking based on personal experiences and what I have heard and what my producer has put down for me to ask you, I want us to try and answer all the questions that will come through via WhatsApp later on when we activate the phone lines as well. So already more messages on 0568 100,000. We'll come to sweet dreams. I'm interested in that. I want to have continuous sweet dreams, and I want to be able to organize and program my dreams. So you'd give us what to do to get there. But here's the question from AJ Kofi says, what about lucid dreams?
Wonderful.
If a dream is a communication from God, then how would we classify lucid dreams, which is to some extent can be controlled?
All right. First of all, I didn't say that all dreams are from God. We'll have to look at the source of dreams, the cause of dreams, and then the cause of dreams.
Okay.
Three dimensions. The source of dreams. There are two personalities necessary for every dream, you and God. You are the source of your dreams. The devil is never the source of any dream.
So me as the individual?
Yes.
Okay.
And you and God are the source of your dreams.
Okay.
Now, the cause of your dreams is just you.
The cause.
Yes. You are the cause of your dreams. Now, the cause of your dreams is you and the devil.
As in the I'll explain road.
That. Yes. The process.
Okay.
The elements of your dream is you and the devil. So you are the source of your dreams, and where you are the source, then it becomes a natural dream, which don't have any spiritual implications. Now, when the source is God, then now it becomes a supernatural dream with consequences in the physical realm. Now, the cause of your dream is just you to either have faith or have fear.
Okay.
When you have faith, then it ignites the word of God and the package of God meant for you. When you have fear, then you become an open field for the enemy to have a course or a part to play in your dream state. Now, let's try and answer the question the young man is asking on lucid dreams. Lucid dreams simply means to sleep and to be aware or to be conscious that you are dreaming whilst you are asleep. So it is an in-between of being awake and still sleeping.
Okay.
Now, that dimension, there are two kinds of lucid dreams. There is a lucid dream that takes you into an out-of-body experience. Then there is a lucid dream that comes to you like a trance.
Okay.
You see, so you realize like you're dozing off, but you're not dozing off. And then you are conscious that you are not asleep, but you're beginning to see things. Mm. The spirit realm opens to you. Images come your way. And at that moment, you have the ability to control the experience. Either to wake yourself up, then the dream ends, or to give yourself over to the mental images that are going through your mind.
Okay.
So,
are you controlling the images? No.
No, you are not controlling the images. You only have the power to stop the dream.
Okay.
Or to carry on with the dream. Now, the images, the control you have over your dreams has to do whether you are of faith or fear. If you are fear, then that becomes the control element of the sequence of images you see. And if you are faith, that would also bring about a certain sequence of elements or dream elements that you would see in your dream state. So now, two dimensions of lucid dreams. At the beginning of your sleep, you realize that as soon as you just start to sleep, you now have what is known as sleep paralysis. You begin to lose any one of your senses and motor ability. So somebody says it in Cree, as a munun tumochime. You see, you begin to become as if you are paralyzed. And in that moment, when you are full of fear, fear takes you over and you want to free yourself. And you cannot, because your fear has become a field's play for the devil.
The explanation is almost like what happens in the afternoon, the experience that I shared.
Exactly.
Like you're saying Jesus, but the Jesus is not coming out.
And if you are not of faith and you are seeing Jesus, what would happen to you? But if you are of faith and you are seeing Jesus, we see several times in the scriptures, you might even fall into a state as if you are dead. But the things you would see would be glorious and heartwarming to your heart.
Mm.
You see. So now lucid dreams, the greater aspect of a lucid dream is what takes us into an out-of-body experience. You are conscious of the elements in your room, where you are, and you can see yourself lie there, and you can also see yourself in two parts. And that actually means that you have flipped the gates of the soul and you have entered into the gates of your spirit. So you begin to see your body, but in the dream state, what you see is your soul lying there because you went to sleep with your body lying there. Now, what we mean by an out-of-body experience simply would mean that you are seeing the soul and now you as a spirit being is standing, just like somebody dies and they see themselves lying there.
Yeah, but with this, what you're just saying, it means that you're not human anymore.
You are, because you still have breath. You see, we are human because the Bible says that God breathed into us and we became living beings. Mm. So as far as you have the breath within you and you have not given up on the breath, you are still human.
Can you take yourself back in there?
Yes. By means of your self-accord.
So you're controlling the moments?
Yes. At that moment. Okay. When you go out of your body, there is a cord that links up with your body, known as a self-accord. And that is what the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, speaks about. And the moment a person dies, the self-accord is severed. Your spirit and your body was connected by God by a cord called the self-accord. And that is a transmission of the soul.
So what do you have to do to experience this?
What you have to do is to understand the mechanism that goes with lucid dreams. Oh. And then you hand yourself over to the experience if you want it.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Because we have a part to play in all spiritual experiences.
So if you have a dream.
Yes.
And you wake up and the dream didn't go quite well.
You just go back and reprogram it. By faith.
How do you do that?
Because.
Now, would you not be, because I think before the conversation I asked something, to be pretending to live a certain experience and then you say, no, dreams are quite different from that. You used a certain word to describe that. Like you're living a cool dream.
I said you are just imagining.
Imagining, uh-huh.
Yes.
So if I woke up from that dream and I put myself back, won't I be imagining the continuation of the dream?
Let me explain something to you. What is faith? Faith is the evidence of things not seen.
Mm.
There is a big difference between imagination and faith. Where your imaginations are mental pictures of the word of God, then it is faith. But where your imaginations are centered within yourself, then it is just pure imaginations and it's not faith. So, when we speak of faith, we are talking about an imagination that was programmed by the word of God.
Mm.
So you know you have a right as a child of God not to have bad dreams. Upon that premise, when we get to how bad dreams come about, would explain so that you don't even have it to reprogram it. Because there is a programming you must do and have in your sleep state so you don't have bad dreams at all.
Okay, so maybe we should continue on that note. How do you program yourself?
So that you don't have bad dreams.
Yes.
Okay. First of all, what is your consciousness built on?
What does that mean?
Now, the Word of God explains to us various consciousness. There is God consciousness, which is founded in the word of God. There is self-consciousness, which is founded in you. There is sin consciousness, which is founded in you on how dirty you are before God. So you see, in the Old Testament, the worshippers coming before God constantly, year after year, could not lose their sin conscience, the consciousness of their sins. So if you are before God and you feel you are dirty and you are a nobody, then at that moment, you are now playing in between self-consciousness and sin-consciousness. To be conscious simply is from two words, with science, you see. So what kind of science are you programmed with? Are you programmed with the science of God? or you are programmed with the signs of this world. So if the signs of God, which is the word of God, is now what you have built within you, and that is what has final authority in your life, and that is what controls everything you are, then you would use that word to control everything that happens in the spirit realm, and which has an effect in the physical realm. And if you win in the spirit, you surely win physically. You get it? So now, let's go back to bad dreams. The foundation of bad dreams is fear. He said in the book of Job, he said, a spirit passed before me, and my hair stood on edge because I was afraid. As soon as you are programmed for fear, you now open yourself for the enemy to project himself into your dreams. The next reason why we have bad dreams is because people have never understood the root of sleep. There are only two people who could give sleep, you and God. He said, he giveth his beloved sweet sleep. Then the next time, he said, don't give sleep to your eyelids. Don't give sleep to your eye, neither slumber to your eyelids. Deliver yourself like a roe from the trap of the enemy. We are supposed to stay within the confinements of the allowable sleep God gives us. So you may now want to ask me, what kind of sleep that does God give?
Sweet sleep.
Sweet sleep.
Okay.
Sweet sleep within two watches. You are not supposed to sleep in the day. If you sleep in the day, you give sleep to your eyes.
Okay.
If you sleep in the night, you must know how long you must sleep. And you must make sure you wake up in the night. And that is how God programmed our body's intelligence, so that during the night, we wake up one time or the other. But for lazy people, when the body's intelligence rings and they are supposed to get up, they continue sleeping. Now the enemy is just standing by and watching you. That sleep that you gave to yourself, which was not given to you by God, becomes an entry point or a portal for the devil to enter in and manipulate your dreams and determine the outcome.
Not even getting into the spirits. I'm sure a lot of people have experienced this. You wake up, the alarm wakes you up.
Yes.
And because you're feeling lazy,
yes,
you give yourself, let me sleep. Do 5 minutes.
You give sleep to
and
your
and before
eyes.
You know, it's
now
6 a.m.
That is a trap, you see. So I have what I call night traps. And the word of God says, deliver yourself. So even if you could just, in a moment, 5 seconds, 10 seconds, open your eyes and thank God for that moment. He says, I meditate on you. I think on you in the night watches. There are actually 3 hours in every watch. So you are not supposed to sleep beyond 3 hours and not open your eyes. At most, around the 5th hour, you are supposed to open your eyes. So what kind of sleep do you have as an adult and you sleep beyond 6 hours without getting up, without opening your eyes to acknowledge the goodness of God? If you go beyond this number of hours, these are sleep that you provided, and you are responsible for yourself, and God is not the one to be accounted for. So at that moment, you would now have to be responsible for all that is happening in your sleep state. But if you stay within the confinements of what God is giving you, and you acknowledge his goodness, sometimes it's not just praying even for an hour or for 2 hours. It is just thanking God. And you know what Jesus did? About the time he was about to die, he went with the disciples to pray. And Jesus came and said, you guys could not even watch with me for an hour. He went and came back for 3 hours. Jesus did that. You are supposed to be up within 3 hours thanking God, my sister. If you don't do that, you have opened up a portal for the enemy to invade your sleep. Then you are sure to understand the physical dimensions of programming your sleep. And then the spiritual dimension has to do with faith. So we just need two programs here, faith and then the length of sleep we have.
I'll go on WhatsApp, but let me ask, is there a general categorization of dreams? Can you say, for instance,
yes,
if I dream and I see this, then it means this?
That has been a trend for a while, especially in this part of our continent, that people interpret dreams. When you see this, it means that. When you see that, it means that. Unless it has to do with the devices of the enemy, then we can say, if the enemy comes in this way, this is what he wants to do. But interpretations belong to God. Interpretations is not in a book somewhere that you say that if you had a dream and you saw flowers, it means good stuff. If you had a dream and you saw a river, it means witchcraft.
Or you saw a crowd.
It means something evil is about happening to you.
So there's nothing flat like that.
Two things. Mm-hmm. We'll have to understand this whole aspect. Where your dream has been invaded by the enemy, then the things you are seeing in there, you would have to be able to tell that this is what the enemy wants to do, because we are not ignorant of the devices of the wicked. So if you want us to talk about the devil's devices that he uses in people's dreams, then we could look at that. Mm. But apart from that, there is not a particular way by which God would speak to you for you to say it means this, because interpretations then will belong to God. Now, you are talking about the classification of dreams.
Yeah.
There are riddles and puzzles which require interpretation.
Okay.
And then there are straight dreams which mean exactly what you saw, and they are clear dreams. And there are things to know that would make you know that this dream is clear. If you keep having repeated dreams, according to the book of Genesis, Joseph told King Pharaoh, he said that this matter that has been doubled to Pharaoh is because God has established it and it will shortly come to pass. So if you have the same dream repetitively, my sister, you are close to a manifestation you need to wake up to attend to.
Okay.
Now, so that is the first aspect of interpreting dreams.
Mm.
Man of God, I've been having this dream repetitively.
Mm.
I don't need anything. I would not need to hear anything from God. What you are having repetitively is going to manifest soon. And it is that which has been established by God. And the word of God says in the book of Genesis, it will shortly come to pass.
Can you reverse it? I mean,
it's evil.
Yes.
If it's evil, then now you need to attend to it by grace.
But
if mm-hmm. it has been determined by the watchers, which is the holy counsel of God that has signed it up in the volumes of the book, then you can't do anything about it.
So how do you know if it's been determined already or if it's something you can pray about?
Wonderful.
So what do you just thank God for whatever situation it is that you are seeing?
We'll now have to, like I said, the classification of dreams is what would help us to understand this.
Mm.
First of all, a dream is said to be clear and does not need interpretation if you see in your dream the form of the Lord, one, the form of angels, two, or the form of heavenly beings. Any of these celestial beings who show up to show you their form, whatever they say will not require interpretation.
Mm.
And whatever experience you have in that state will not require
interpretation. Because it is clear.
Because it's called a clear dream.
Okay.
Another clear dream will now be repetitive dreams.
Okay.
These are the dreams that are referred to as clear or apparent visions,
mm.
you see. So when God called Miriam and his brother Aaron, he said, "You are prophets, but I speak to you in visions and in dreams. But I don't do that with Moses. I speak to him apparently, and I speak to him clearly. And there is no puzzles about it.
Mm.
But with you people, when I speak to you, you need to interpret it."
Is there a reason?
The reason was because God chose to deal with Moses differently from the way he chose to deal with Miriam and Aaron. And so whenever you dream, when you go through the Bible, the Bible says, "And an angel of the Lord appeared,"
mm.
"and God, the Lord appeared unto Solomon." You see, any of these celestial beings that you see in your dreams does not require interpretation.
Even to Joseph, it was clear.
It was clear.
But so why do we then always, no matter the kind of dream that we have, most often would go to a prophet and say that this was the dream?
It's because we have not been taught to understand how to interpret our dreams. The very first thing you have to do when you wake up from your dream state and you don't understand what you're dreaming about is to seek mercies from God. In the book of Daniel, when King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, he sought for one in whom is light, that the spirit of the gods dwelt in. Every believer, we are children of light. The light of God is within us to cause us to be able to interpret our dreams. Unless it becomes complex and overwhelming, then you would need an interpreter. So when my church folks come to me with a dream, I ask them, what interpretation did you get first? Because I would have to raise and grow the person in Christ so that the person can come to stand at a place where now it is their dream. It is not my dream. They should be able to see bits into it before I, as a prophet or as a man of God, adds to it.
Here's Starbright saying, I'm loving the exposition on dreams. God bless you, Pastor Obed. And we're activating the lines right now. 0302-216-9102. And even before I announce the line, I understand that somebody holding on, that's Felix from Obuasi. Hello, Felix. Thanks for your call. Let's hear you.
Hello.
Hello, Felix. We can hear you.
Hey. Madam, good morning. Pastor Felix is a friend, but me, if I may, Alice.
Okay.
And I make a star.
Me patro you. Me patro you too.
Pastor, teachings now all you know. Now, I can't be about that. But me da, me jane bonnie, me jane, I dream papa, but me to be done on my foot. Daya Daya Basabasa. I am a Christian.
O die na ye be mo na abemuda
bi wo ho a bi wo mi emme mo te se daye na ka san ka sa bad mi tinu ni emme bi a it looks like daye no.
Okay, all right, so let's try and thank you very much Auntie Alice and Felix for calling for Auntie Alice to speak to us.
Just to help the Auntie Alice, the issue is that what has Auntie Alice been sowing in the 12 hours of the day? We are not just looking at the single thoughts you had on your mind just before you went to sleep. Has she programmed herself during the day to feed on the word of God? If that is the premise, then out of the abundance of what she has in her heart, she could feed on one of them before she sleeps, and surely they would all play in her dream state. So she should program herself with the word of God and ensure that she's in praise, she is loving God, and she is confessing right, and she's living the life and walking the life of faith. Else, if she's programmed herself within 6 hours of the day with fear, and she thinks that in 1 minute of going to sleep, that one thing that she has on her mind would conquer all the fears of 6 hours, they will really show up in a dream.
This is so real. Yes. This is so real. Something is coming back to me, but let's go to Cape Coast. Eric is on the line. Hello, Eric. Good morning.
Good morning, Mama V.
Yes, Eric. Thanks for calling. Let's hear you.
Yes, I think this man is so deep. He's indeed a man of God. And personally, I see dreams to be an embodiment of one's wish, embodiment of one's desire. A classical example I want to add to this is, take it for instance, I'm a young guy who is desiring a lady and thinks about that lady all the time. Most definitely when I go to sleep, I'll be having dreams of that lady, talking to that lady or meeting that lady. That has been the definition I've given to dream all this while. So if this man of God is saying that if you have the word in you, you meditate upon it all the time, then of course that is exactly what you're going to see in your dreams.
Exactly.
At a point in time, I needed a job. I've been thinking about this job all the time. I went to sleep, and sometimes I find myself in an interview field. Sometimes I find myself in that job. Sometimes I'm talking to a friend about that job. So I believe that since I am saying it's an embodiment of our wish and our desire, for us to get sweet dreams, for us to have good dreams, and for us to see the manifestation of God's purpose in our life, then all the time we have to keep to the word,
exactly.
Understand the word,
exactly.
And think positive.
Yeah.
That, I believe, we'll be able to see good dreams and we'll be able to be happy in our dreams. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eric and Cape Coast. And we'll continue with Asa in Bolga. Hello, good morning, Asa.
Good morning, Mavi.
I hope you're well.
Yeah, I'm very well.
We thank God. Let's hear you.
I just want to congratulate Obet. I think the year 2000 to 2004, he used to preach in tech.
Yes, it's true.
And I am really surprised to still see him continuing with the good work.
Amen.
So I encourage him to continue.
Amen.
But the other aspect of an adult sleeping over five hours, that I'm a bit, listen, imagine, Mama V, you go to the bush to work the whole day.
Yes.
You come home maybe around 8, take your supper.
Good.
You fall to sleep. 5 hours, I don't know whether it's enough for the body to really rest for you to.
I get you.
All right.
Very interesting. Yeah. But thanks for sharing. And I'll continue before you even comment. And I know I have Mr. T holding on, but I need to attend to WhatsApp as well. Here's somebody, Reginald Zomelo says, I'm really enjoying the program. Mm. So from what you are saying, fear is the devil's key to ruling us in our sleeps.
Exactly.
More often than not, my dreams always come to pass. How do you determine whether a dream is bad or good if God is the one behind it? If the dream is bad and God is the one revealing it in order to save you or a life, how would you define it? God reveals to redeem. Hmm. So does programming yourselves before our sleep affect God's revelation to us? Do we have a positive fear and a negative fear? And a negative fear. Thank you. That's from Reginald Zomelo. But let me continue with Mr. T and then you can we box all up. From Sukura. Mr. T, good morning.
Hello.
Hi, Mr. T. We can hear you.
Yeah, my name is Peter T. I'm calling from Sukura.
Very well.
Thanks for this program. You know, for me, my interest is always politics. Where, you see, when you brought the gentleman on, I nearly, you know, just changed the station to other stations that would give me political, you know, programs. But it's so interesting that this gentleman today is taking us through some light, something that we have been missing for some time now. But you see, about the sleeping, the two ways of sleeping, God's interventional sleeping and then your own way of just getting lazy and thinking that you have to give yourself rest and then you are sleeping. You see, but the other side is that sometimes you go to the hospital and the doctor will tell you that you need a rest.
Mm.
And you tell the doctor, of course, sometimes I sleep as late as 12 o'clock and by 3, 4 o'clock, I have to wake up. And doctor will tell you that, no, you need more time, you know, to rest. So sleeping will do. And I don't know how we are falling short here, whether we should go by the doctor's advice or we should still stick on God's interventional sleep, whereby once you sleep for 3-5 hours and you wake up, and that is all. I don't know this.
No, but Mr. T, I'm sure, sorry to butt in, but I'm sure that there's a reason for the doctor to tell you you need more sleep.
Mm.
There's a reason you went to see the doctor.
So, Hello, Mama V.
Yes, Mr. T.
Yes, there's a reason, but let me also tell you that God, as a supreme, you know, being, you know, has given us some sort of spiritual, you know, movement in our life. So once we are talking about God, I think God's intervention supersedes, you know, doctor's intervention. So I don't think that doctor's own advice would supersede that of God. So
all
I'm
right.
saying that the general advice is so brilliant in such a way that we must begin to learn, you know, out of some of these,
I don't want
to call it mistakes, but, you know, you are tired, you go to work, you are tired, and you think that afternoon time, because it talks of afternoon time, maybe you are sleeping within the day, and you think that maybe you are resting. But it's also, you know, but so let's keep on giving people education, and that will go a long way to help it.
I get you. Thank you very much, Mr. T from Sukura. Let's speak to Niada. And I can't help it. I know you want to comment, but I need to at least try and get all the views, most of them at least. Ni, hello? Hello, Ni? Niada, good morning. All right, I lost you, and I sincerely apologize because you've been holding on for a while. Okay.
All right, let me comment on what our viewers have said. I'm not conflicting with doctor's
advice
and prescription.
Yeah.
What, if you heard me right, I spoke about even a moment of getting up out of your sleep. And I spoke of the body's intelligence. Now, the other brother who says he knows me from Bulga, it doesn't matter how tired you are. You wake up to at least, let me use the slang word, wee-wee. All of these interruptions are inbuilt systems of God to get you up out of your sleep according to what God has programmed for you. So if you feel like wee-weeing or urinating, get up and do it. And if your body itself does not wake you up, then you would not have to know how to program yourself to get up. And you know, some of the times, nobody sleeps 6 hours straight. It doesn't happen. You have interruptions in between your sleep. And those interruptions are gateways of God to deliver you from every trap of the enemy. But laziness makes you to add on. And this is what we are saying. So if the doctor says you should sleep for, say, 8 hours, yes, be in that state or enjoy that 8 hours of sleep. But then respond to your body's intelligence. And in those interruptions, give God praise. Stay in worship. Thank God for the night. Declare that the next round of sleep should be deeper revelations of what God wants to send to you. And thank Him for what you have seen already. And bless Him. If you are able to program yourself this way, you surely would have good sleep.
If you don't dream at all, is that a bad thing?
I'm sorry. You would need to be prayed for.
Yeah?
Yes, if you don't dream at all.
I haven't dreamt in a while, so you better start praying for me.
If you haven't dreamt in a while, it's understandable. But you shouldn't go a month without seeing anything in your dreams.
Okay.
You see, the reason why people don't dream at all, I'm sure there are loads of viewers who might say, Pastor, I don't dream. The reason is because there is a spirit known as the spirit of stupor. And that spirit, when it is projected into a person's dream state, stops him from seeing anything. It is also referred to as the spirit of blindness. Now, the spirit of blindness controls the eye, and the spirit of stupor dulls the mind. And these twin spirits are projected from covens, or from witchcraft covens, or from the dark world, to seize or sedate us from seeing the packages of God. And you know, when you see the things God has programmed for you, and you wake up to confess them and to establish them, they come to pass. But because they know that you have a part to play in what God is sending to you, now they project these spirits of stupor and blindness to stop you from seeing what God has for
they
you.
They block the transmission.
Exactly.
That's why I said all of you should read Uncle Ibo's book, The Deal. Okay. Nana Boache Nkumasi is on the line. Hello, Nana Boache. Thanks for your call.
Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, please. I want to ask Pastor some dreams I'll be having of late. When it was, I used to have these dreams when I was in America. Anytime I sleep, I can see myself like either I'm walking barefooted.
He's what?
I'm walking barefooted. I'm not with sandals. I'm not with shoe.
Okay.
Keep on coming. So I started praying about it, but I didn't understand. So when I started praying, I stopped. For almost 6 months, I didn't have those dreams again.
Okay.
But for some time, I keep on coming again.
Okay.
Even last 2 weeks when I came again, I had that same dream. I didn't understand. Walking barefooted.
Okay.
If you like.
Yeah, Nana Watch, is there more?
Hello?
Okay, so that's the problem. You have the dream is is repetitive. It's the same thing that keeps coming back.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Nana Boache. Let's hear Mensah from Nkwanta, and then I'll give you the opportunity to address that. Mm-hmm. Hello, Mensah.
Hello, madam.
Yes, sir. Thanks for your call. Okay. You Mensah, that's it. Self prayer. All right, so
I react to those two. I'll start with the brother from Dia Nkwanta. His dream is wonderful. And if I had such a dream, I'll celebrate and thank God.
Yeah.
The reason being that we as spiritual beings have wings. You might not see it this way, but it's there. The Bible says that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They would mount up with wings like eagles. You see, and the Bible says that they would run, they would not be weary, they would walk, they would not faint. This brother who dreams and sees an oncoming incident that makes him to fly simply is being shown his spiritual state. And it would mean that he takes his prayer life seriously and the things he's praying about are producing effects in the spirit. So he should keep on with what he's doing.
Okay.
Because that is what is being played. So the programs, the programming he's been experiencing in the day with prayer, with his taking his spiritual life seriously, is what is showing up in his dreams in the night. So for such a person, he is strongly powerful. His spirit man, his soul is very powerful. So he should just keep on and thank God. And the reason why it will repeat over and over and over and over is because his smartest way of escape is his wings.
Okay.
In the spirit. His wings are more potent than other arsenals of his body. You see, our body, in the Greek, he says they are hoplons, or they are instruments of power. And the Bible says we should yield our members as instruments of power to God. So this young man surely must have been yielding his wings to God for a big flight.
Good for you, Mensa. Yes. So keep praying. That's the message.
Now, the on final the other brother who sees himself
walking barefooted,
I would love to have asked him a couple of questions.
Okay.
The first question is, what is the scenario? Because when you appear before God in the spirit realm, you would have to take off your shoes like Moses. He says that the grounds on which you are standing is holy grounds. So to be able to give him perfect understanding of what he's experiencing, when I get the details of the dream, then we could add on.
So ask but him, then he says, what are you doing when you're barefooted?
When you were barefooted.
Okay.
Okay. Were you in the presence of God? Or where were you walking to?
Okay.
Or where were you walking from?
All right.
Then the details of that could be, could help the interpretation.
Okay. So I can ask Nana Boachi to call us right back after,
but there is
just
a clue.
When we wrap up.
There is a clue to what he said. He says that when he started praying, it stopped.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Now, if he started praying and it stopped and it repeated again, it could be that his will repelled what God wanted to do with him. Or it could be that his prayers hindered what the devil has been programming against him. But if it's repetitive, he should know that it will surely come to pass, whatever it is, be it good or evil.
Okay. Would you advise that he calls right back?
I'll be grateful.
Okay, all right. So Nana Boachi, call right back when you see us wrap up. George is in Termine, Michelle is in Ho. You're my last two callers. I appreciate you holding. I'll speak to George first. George is in Termine. Let's hear you. Good morning. Hello, George. Oh, George. I hope Michelle is on. Hello, Michelle from Ho. Hello, Michelle. Okay, and I lost Michelle too. Really apologize, George and Michelle. But this book is a lot of help.
It's a masterpiece.
It's like you speaking right now,
exactly.
You talking to us and everybody calling.
Yes.
So tell us where this is available so that people can get hold of the book.
We could leave some right in your studios
here
for people to pass by and pick them. Or you could pick them up in any of our networks or our churches. Yes. In Accra, we are at East Legon, and then also I think we would leave our numbers so that people could call in.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
So if we could get, you could also get it from our headquarters in Kumasi.
In Kumasi.
Yes, from our bookshops.
All right.
Yes.
And the church is Christ Cosmopolitan Incorporated.
Yes.
Okay. But I'm told that you have a program.
Yes.
This
tonight.
Evening.
Yes.
All right. Tell us about
awesome.
It.
Awesome. Tarry night. It's going to be explosive. It's a night of word, prophecy, power, miracles, and the impossible will be made possible. It's an all-night meeting all across the country and all over the globe.
Okay, so it means that all the branches are doing the same
exactly.
as the Accra branch is doing today.
Yes, yes, yes. And wherever you are, you want to make it a point to be in any of these all-night meetings.
Okay.
Closest to you, you'll be blessed.
All right, so in Accra, where can we find the church?
At East Legon.
Okay.
Yes. Right opposite the MTN office.
Okay.
Yes.
So this is towards American House.
American House,
all right.
Exactly.
Okay. Exactly. And the time is?
The time is 6 p.m. exactly.
6 p.m. exactly.
Yes.
So you're leaving us how many books?
Are
you leaving us, because it's 35 Ghana cedis. So
yes, please. I could get you more,
okay,
depending on the numbers,
okay,
that would want it.
All right.
But I brought as much of them.
Okay.
Yes.
So if you're around, or you can make it to our office, we've got the book is 35 Ghana cedis for one. And then if you can find your way also to Christ Cosmopolitan Incorporated, you can also, it's a very sophisticated name, by the way. You can also go to the branches and then get a copy. But I'm getting a phone number so that we can also put it out and then people can call. But Nana Bwachi, kindly call us. Nana Bwachi, you call from Kumasi, kindly call us right after the program. What's the prayer? You know, when I got to the bit where you said your personal story, you don't even pray before you sleep. I thought,
yes.
Okay, so what's the perfect... what's the perfect prayer to say before you go to bed?
There's no perfect prayer. Prayers actually are not said. Prayers are prayed anyway. So there's no perfect prayer. Just thank God and go to sleep, that's all. And receive the sweet sleep God gives you. The Bible says he giveth his beloved sweet sleep. Just receive it by faith and go and sleep. And you can also set yourself to receive it as far as you are here on earth. And so you program yourself. I receive sweet sleep. You go through the day thanking God, walking in fellowship with the Spirit. Then when it's time to sleep, you just fall off to sleep.
Yeah.
It's just as simple as that.
Amen. So here's the phone number to call, 050-546-6391. 050-546-6391. 050-546-6391. My producer says we'll do part two of it. I think it's been arranged even without your permission. But I am so grateful. I thank you.
I'd love to come again.
I thank you so much for sharing.
Amen.
And I love that you could make it. I could use the rest of the 5 minutes that Becky's coming to do entertainment to thank you, but we have to go. So
you're welcome.
Thanks a lot for being here.
You're welcome.
That's Obed Obing. A day.
Yes, please.
Are you a prophet? Are you a pastor? Are you a reverend? I mean, how does it work?
I do as occasion serves me.
But he's an evangelist. I love that. Thank you.
I'm a pastor.
Yeah. Stay with us. Becky is right after
yes.
this
yes.
With entertainment. Whilst Nana Bwachi, we wait for your phone call.